name's Robert Lucero. I'm a new member from San Leandro, California. And my address is to Lynn. I've never seen you before, never met you, but I should say that we have met several times and had discussions several times while you were imprisoned. And this is, of course, through your writings. And I was advised to discuss things with you that way. And it's a pleasure to see you here. Now, I have a question which I think is relevant to our conference, and it's more of a detail and a larger question, and it's on this it's on the yuppies, which is part of the problem. And as you called them in your subject of God paper, the blobs. Okay, and I'm possibly looking for the connection or the difference. I'm learning physical economy and the flaws of the Economics 101, which I was in a year ago. It's system and its axioms. And the question is this: what is Wall Street? Okay, should it really be nuked, as we say? If not, where do stocks and bonds, mutual funds, and so forth fit in a physical productive economy?
Well, one thing you can do with Wall Street, just to get the easiest part out of the way, I think what we should do is make it a kind of a zoo. And what we can do is we'll just take and evacuate all the people who presently work there, and thus actually improving the economy by that purpose. We can take then the vacant buildings and use them to house endangered species. And those who want to do that, we can volunteer to go out and feed these species. Right. Unless they're sharks, in which case it would be rather dangerous. But anyway. Now, the yuppie is a very simple phenomenon. It's a very bad phenomenon. I came back at the end of the war. I was very much inspired or motivated by my experience in Asia during the war, and especially in India, in those crucial months of early 46. Then, and I thought a lot of other people with me were too. I was elected to represent soldiers at some big convention we were going to have there at the time about post-war conditions. And they moved me around as a security risk of some kind because they got elected. I wasn't even running. They just elected me. But I came back motivated, and I thought the people who'd voted for me and without my consent, really, were also motivated. I came back and they weren't. They changed. They're my age. I'm, 71. People of that age, the people in the 80s, down to, say, 70 to 80 today, generally my age group. They came back from the war, and the first whiff of recession, they thought the Depression was coming back, and the Lockean motives of life, liberty, and property put happiness out of the way. They became good Kantians, which meant they were completely emptied themselves of all happiness. Then they began to breed children. But they weren't happy people. They began seeking pleasure. Acquisition and pleasure. And they stuck their children in front of a boob tube. The one-eyed Satan's monster. And the one-eyed monster became the babysitter. And they bought Freud. And thus they were able to teach their children how to have neuroses. If they had enough money, they could pay a psychiatrist to make their child neurotic. And I must say, some of them were really professional at that. Then they invented something later on which never existed in my time called a midlife crisis. Until a psychiatrist invented it, no one ever thought of having one. Besides, you really couldn't afford it in my days. You know, we didn't have that kind of money. But what happened is, in this stinking situation, That Schiller has a term which describes many of my friends who went back to finish their college and get their degrees and so forth, Brotgelehrten. They didn't go to school because of the joy of mastering something, the idea that they would pick out something which they enjoy doing and make a profession of it. No, they picked out a profession based on what they thought the yield was, financial. Then they went out to study that and get through the course and get the sheepskin and get out in politic and get promoted and make money so they could have a happy married life sleeping with a neighbor's wife. This is what happened in many cases. Not all of them, but this was a standard. This was a degeneration of my generation. And they had children. And the children became very, very shallow. There was no deep depth of family life. Oh, yeah, that's the usual thing. But it really, the core of it wasn't there. They were cynical. Then we had the post-war McCarthyism, gay Edgar Hoover chasing homosexuals. Remember the essence of the hypocrisy. Here you have gay Edgar Hoover, the queen of the Ku Klux Klan. Sending gay Roy Cohn out into the Washington, D.C. diplomatic government circles to parties, coming back and reporting who's a homosexual, turning the list over to gay Edgar Hoover, who now has the homosexuals, or suspected ones, persecuted. All done by saying that all homosexuals were national security risks. Why'd they have one in charge of MI5? This was the era of immorality, the era of Eisenhower, who was president for one term, served two terms, was president for one, and played golf for the other. I once called him, a friend of mine used the word, and I called him President Dwight Eisenhower. But that was the kind of generation. And then I met these children of my generation, my progeny. Between 1966 and 1973, I was running around some campuses giving this one semester course, which Mr. Chaikin remembers quite well. And others, Mr. Pappas remembers, oh yes, Mr. Rose, and others, well, a whole bunch of them, right? Look around. And I met them. Now, these people belong to that generation of the sons and daughters of my generation. They went to college, went to suburbia or something like that, and they went to college. And I met them as students at college in these classes. And they were sane. They were quirky, but sane. But you should see what the other kind was. The other kind was your budding environmentalist, already that. The other kind was the Jewish son of a military officer who turned kook with the aid of pot, LSD, and who knows what else, and was throwing bombs as a weatherman. And those that didn't have the guts to throw bombs became accountants or something like that, or sociologists. And those guys, who we considered the kooks of 1968 to 1972. I stopped teaching in 1973. Maryland. They're running the foundation. They're running the major corporations, or at least the major divisions of them. They're running Wall Street. They're running the banks. Those are your diplomats. Those are most of your members of Congress. What's the age group? 45 to 55. Those are the people that are in Mars, in the controlling positions of institutions in the United States today. I met most of them, and some of them I met personally, on the campuses around the country between 1966 and 1973. We know them very well. We met them. We know them. We know how they tick. Tick, tock, tick, tick, tick. They bong sometimes, too. We know them. We saw them filled up with after an LSD trip on hash, half drunk, babbling, unable to put out a complete sentence. They couldn't parse a complete statement. These people and their attitudes, with the aid of Chomsky and with the aid of deconstructionism in general, are running our institutions, are leading above all the environmentalist fanatic groups today. These are the yuppies. These are what Jonathan Swift described of the England of his time, the yahoos. These are the people, you remember, he described England as the place which is ruled by the rear ends of horses. And the lower classes were the yahoos, who looked something like hominids or but behaved like baboons. And that's what's happened. When we turn the country over to people who were turned into yahoos by the negligence, the amorality within their generations, my generation's household rearing, we put them in Wall Street. These people can't think. I'm not exaggerating. They can't think. They're not qualified to handle anything. They can't, let alone government. They don't know what industry is. They don't know what production is. CIA policy. Statements coming into public. That's not humanity. That's not policy. That's degeneracy. All right, these people have been willing to go along with these policies. But the whole blasted world is going. It's not just the Bolshevik system. We're coming to the end not simply of an economic system. We're coming to the end of an era. We're coming to the end of a century. In 1898, the British government, through Lord Grey in particular, found himself a French political catamite by the name of Théophile Delcasse, who is an expression of the what was then called the revanchist tendency in French politics, which is also was an extension of the Napoleon III group, as described so aptly by the famous French novelist Balzac. The worst characters in Balzac are the revanchists of France. And the British in 1898 has succeeded in starting World War I. That's the beginning of this period. Fashoda. World War I. That whole system in the United States and elsewhere has those ideas, the ideas of geopolitics, the ideas of usury, the ideas of free trade, this whole melange of sociology, psychology, other kinds of mental disorders, come to the point that the whole blasted system is gone. Now, in this circumstance, where what people have thought they ought to believe in, whether they believed or not, where all of that is crashing down, do people want to hear a new idea? No, they don't want to hear a new idea. They're afraid of new ideas. They've already had too many of these ideas, which were each novel in their own time. The history of ideas in this period has been nothing but novelty. Ideas change more rapidly than women's dress fashions. That's the characteristic of the period, like television program series, that sort of thing. Now, what they want to know, wait a minute. You mean they were all wrong? That everybody was wrong? We were all stupid? We all made these mistakes? We couldn't find a person to vote for who didn't betray us. We couldn't find a party. We couldn't even buy a car that functioned. They don't want to hear a new idea. They want to know, isn't there someone somewhere on this landscape who has been telling the truth? And that's what you do. You get, you know, it's like a revival meeting, like a religious revival meeting when people discover God. Suddenly they think they've been getting along just fine. I don't need that stuff. And then sometimes the awesomeness of their circumstance overwhelms them. And they realize that they are not the little Dionysiac devils who can do anything they want to and get by with it. There's some crushing force. And they say, where is something powerful, more powerful than me? Because my little Dionysiac devil can't solve all his problems for me. We have to bring them authority. The authority of truth. The authority of proven analysis. Not just what I represent together with my associates, because we're just a continuation of something. When other people weren't continuing. The authority in science, the authority in music, the authority in philosophy, the authority in statecraft, the authority of George Washington, for example, of Hamilton, the authority of Friedrich Liszt, the authority of Count Sergei Witte, the authority of Dmitri Mendeleev, the authority of Gauss, the authority of Cantor. Yes, people all around you, while you were following these false prophets, truth was there for you if you had troubled yourself to look for it. Now, what do we offer you? We offer you one thing. We offer you truth, and we offer you ourselves as persons who have been trustees and caretakers of the truth that you now need. When people who have been self-complacent, self-content, self-conceited, with bad ideas, find themselves being crushed by events, that all the things that they chose to believe were acceptable and authoritative are crashing down, they want to know a truth on which they can rely, not some novelty. And that's what we must offer them. Because in this crushing moment, even a yuppie can discover belatedly his or her humanity.